Now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for attending tonight's webinar on smartphone imaging and ophthalmology with Dr. John Akkara. This is the last webinar for December, so don't forget to take your quiz to receive credits. If you have any questions, please type them in the question box. Dr. John Davis Akkara is a glaucoma consultant at Little Flower Hospital, Angamali, and West End Eye Hospital, Cochin. He has completed his MBBS and MS ophthalmology from JITMER and glaucoma fellowship and phaco training from Irvine Eye Hospital, Pondicherry. He has also completed the Ratan Tata Advanced Cataract Fellowship in Sankara, Netralaya. He has presented in a state, national, and international conferences and has won awards for smartphone-based virtual reality, perimetry, smartphone ophthalmic photography, and virtual reality and ophthalmology. He has publications on innovations in ophthalmology, including DIY RetCam and ophthalmic apps. He is into technology and gadgets and does programming and website designing. He has worked on Raspberry Pi-based surgery recorder and has made some ophthalmic apps for the Google Play Store. Now I would love to turn it over to you, Dr. Akkara.
Thank you, everyone. So I will start this session on smartphone imaging in ophthalmology. So if you look at this picture on the left, this is a slit lamp photograph taken using a smartphone. This was taken using my regular Android smartphone, and you can see the pigments on the endothelium. And there are lots of tips I can just tell you on how to get the best smartphone photographs of slit lamp photographs, fundus photographs, as well as other photographs. I have no financial interest in this presentation. I do make some apps, but they are free apps, and I don't have any financial interest in this. So why click photographs? Being ophthalmic photographers, all of you know the importance of photographs. It is for documentation. You can get expert opinion from these photographs, that is teleophthalmology. You can monitor the progression and regression of multiple lesions like corneal ulcers, abrasions, SEKs, pterygium, squamous neoplasms of the conjunctiva, hemorrhages. Patients can see their lesions for a better understanding of the disease. If the patient has a foreign body, you can show them, you can show the abrasions. And patients, once they have a good understanding of their disease, they will be more adherent to the therapy that you prescribe. You can also use software to measure area of lesions. And on this side, you can see a photograph where the fundus of this patient is taken using just a 20 diopter lens and a smartphone. I am not using any other equipment in this photograph. I'm not using an indirect ophthalmoscope. The lighting is from the smartphone's flash, and the image is recorded directly on the smartphone. So why smartphone imaging? Because the best camera is the one that is always with you. So you always have your smartphone with you. You do not have your fundus camera. You do not have your slit lamp camera. If you are in need of taking a quick photograph, this is the best camera because that is with you. It's portable. You can do a quick review. You can do editing. You can share. You can have an online backup, and it is affordable. On this side, you can see cataract, cortical cataract. And because it's a retro illumination, you can see the peripheral iridotomy. So I'm a glaucoma specialist. In glaucoma in particular, you have gonioscopy, optic disc photographs, retinal nerve fiber layer, slit images for the anterior chamber depth grading, that is a Van Herrick's grading, and for teaching videos, how to do Goldman applanation, tonometry, YAG, peripheral iridotomy, and all that. So on the left, this is a gonioscopic photograph. All these photographs are taken with smartphone. I just wanted to remind you. And I find that compared to the conventional smart slit lamp camera, which we have here, these smartphone photographs give more detail. So if you have a smartphone and you can take good photographs, you do not need to go for a high-end equipment, especially in places where you cannot afford that. And on the right side, you can see a fundus photograph taken through a 90 diopter lens. And this shows a coloboma of the fundus, chorioretinal coloboma. And on this side, you can see Goldman applanation tonometry. Here you can see a gonioscopic photograph showing the peripheral iridotomy and a membrane coming from the iridotomy to the ostium of the trap. So this is a surgical iridotomy of a trabeculectomy surgery. And this is a fundus disc image showing glaucomatous cupping. So you can do multiple photographs. You can keep checking what the change is, very important in glaucoma to know if the disease is progressing or not. And in cornea, it is also very important. So if there is pseudo exfoliation, you can see that. You can see pigments on the endothelium. You can do retroillumination. You can do fluorescein staining, tear breakup time. So with a smartphone, you can take videos also. You can usually, if you just take a photograph, it's worth 1,000 words, but a video is worth much more. So you need to see where the need for a video is and take videos also. So that is one aspect where video is important. And I also will show you some images of specular imaging of the corneal endothelium. So for smartphone slit lamp photography, these are some adapters which can be used. I use this one here on the right. It is sold on Amazon. Here in India, we get it on Amazon. I suppose it is there in Amazon in all countries. This is a universal adapter. You can adjust the phone holding part of the adapter, fix your smartphone, and adjust the adapter to fit the eyepiece of any microscope, surgical microscope, or several other devices which have an eyepiece. These are modifications. This is a smartphone cover which is fixed onto the back of a cylindrical plastic base, which can be fitted onto the eyepiece. This is another plastic model which can be fitted onto the eyepiece. These have the disadvantage of blocking one eyepiece of the microscope. So instead of that, if you have a beam splitter based version, which can be inserted into the beam splitter as a C mount, and the camera is fixed, the smartphone camera is fixed here, you can record while you're doing a procedure in stereopsis. And this is a surgery being recorded. And this is feasible to record like this if you have an observer scope. So the main surgeon will be operating on one main surgical microscope, while the observer scope can be used for recording. So this is in Arvind Eye Hospital, Pondicherry, where we have a teaching microscope with an observer scope in every operation theater. So in that case, surgical recording with that adapter is quite useful. I believe this is an iPhone 6. And one more advantage of recording surgeries like this, you can get a wider field of view. You can change the focus to whatever is of interest at that point. And I will just show you a video of how I fixed that. In the meantime, this is another slit lamp image showing lots of pigments lying in the inferior angle. So I will just show you. I suppose the music is a little loud. Okay. So this is, I will show you how to fix the adapter. So you open this and fit the smartphone onto the adapter, making sure that these rubber holders do not press any of the buttons, because smartphones have their power button and volume button in these areas. You have to make sure the buttons are not pressed. Once you tighten that, you can adjust the other part of the holder so that it's centered on the camera. So in this case, the smartphone camera is on the side, but still you can tilt it to the side, fix it like that. and fix the entire thing onto the eyepiece of the slit lamp, and then you can get a view through the slit lamp. So if you turn off the room lights, you will get less glare. I'm covering the top of the eyepiece because there was some glare in low light. So if you turn off the room lights, you get a better image. And this is with the patient. So diffuse illumination is easy to get. Once you want to change to a slit illumination, you need to make sure to avoid the maximum reflection and you need to touch to focus. So once this area is touched to focus, and you can even adjust the brightness once you do a focus lock. So that is how you fix and take photographs with a smartphone on a slit lamp. There are several camera apps which you can use. One is the regular camera app, which is available, which is quite good in most of the newer phones. You can use Camera FV5 or Cinema FV5. So Cinema FV5 is more for videos. Then on iPhone, Filmic Pro is one of the better ones. And then there is Open Camera. All these are pretty good apps, including the default camera apps in most of the phones. There's also one more app called Slit Lamp Camera, which also has some additional settings to help you. So you can take clear photographs with diffuse. With slit images, it's slightly more difficult. You need to touch to focus. So you need to keep the flash off. This is for slit lamp photograph. HDR off. All the newer smartphones, they come with all these extra features. So HDR should be off, and portrait mode, beautification mode should be off. Especially in the new iPhone, on the front camera, they keep no option to turn off the beautification mode. So that is things which you have to look for in the newer phones. Touch to focus is better kept on. So you can see the lesion, touch that area, focus on the lesion, and then take the photograph. Metering mode also can be kept on touch. In some apps, you can adjust the metering and the focus separately. Most of them have that on the same point. You can zoom in a little bit. So digital zoom is not very good, but you can zoom in a little bit to get your area of focus. Slit lamp light, it should be not too bright. It should be comfortable for the patient. And the room light should be preferably turned off. So exposure low, depending on the brightness of the slit lamp. So here you can see vitreous coming out of the pupillary margin. So these things are where you need to adjust your settings carefully. You have to make a slit. And if you wanted to see the cornea, you had to touch the cornea on the screen and adjust the focus and exposure there. But here, the object of interest is the vitreous. So you need to touch to focus there and adjust everything for that. So then exposure, focus, white balance. So depending on the older slit lamps, which are yellow, you can keep it on yellow. Or if it is an LED slit lamp, which are mostly white, you have to keep it on fluorescent for the LED white slit lamps. If you keep an auto, many a time it does pick up automatically, but sometimes it struggles to find the correct white balance. So just make sure that your photograph turns out in the correct illumination. The ISO can be kept low for most photos. You can keep it higher for lower photos, low light, but then you know that the grains do come up. So you need to adjust them accordingly. So shutter speed also, you can keep it faster if it's a moving eye or you need to capture something with good illumination. So slit images, you have to make a thin slit. You can see a lot of grains in this photograph because there is no extra background illumination. You need to, one, focus on the slit, and two, give an extra background illumination, which can be done with another smartphone with the flash on also, if you want to do everything by smartphone, or if you have a flashlight, you can use that. Once you have the extra illumination, this photograph would have turned out better, with the details on the sides also visible, with the slit also visible. And here, if you look closely, you can see not only the slit, there is a Morganian sunken cataract. There is white milky fluid and a sunken nucleus. So this is where the sunken nucleus can be seen. It's not very visible, but it can be seen if you look closely. And there is, this is a gonioscopic photograph which shows, this is a slit lamp photograph which shows pseudo exfoliation in the inferior angle. So this is a big piece of pseudo exfoliative material. That is why it can be seen like this. Most of the time, it can be seen only on gonioscopy. This is a focal decimate membrane detachment due to accidental YAG laser injury to the cornea during a YAG laser peripheral eye ductomy. So all these are slit images which need more focus and lighting techniques to get good photographs of. And also, when you have a photograph, you need to always choose what is your area of interest. So in this particular photograph, this sort of calcification on the anterior capsule was my area of interest. So I have put the slit out of my field of image. There is a bright glare here, but it doesn't matter because I'm going to crop the photograph like this. So this is my area of interest. Keep the bright slit illumination, which gives reflections on the cornea, out of your frame, and the inner light beam illuminates your anterior capsule well. So you can adjust all your settings depending on your area of interest. This is a corneal dystrophy. I have used diffuse illumination. A slit illumination would have also given a better idea of where the dystrophy is in the cornea, whether it is in the anterior stroma, whether it is in the posterior stroma, or is it on one of the layers. And here you can see a decimate tear. This is also very difficult to photograph. You need to focus on the decimate tear as well as reduce the brightness, and you need to keep the illumination at an angle of around 60 degrees so that you can see it clearly. And this shows another game of shadows, why you need to take care of your illumination, because illumination is everything in photography, as you all know. So in this patient, this is possibly a posterior polar cataract, but once I turn the illumination a little bit to the side, I can see this posterior fishtailing of the cataract. So this is due to the lens epithelial cells migrating posteriorly into the vitreous. It is not seen in this photograph because the illumination was such, but in this photograph, when the illumination goes behind the lens, you can see that it is definitely a posterior polar cataract with a fishtailing into the vitreous. So you need to take multiple photographs. You need to make sure that you get all the details, all the clues, so that you can diagnose the disease and better document the photographs. And this is a traumatic cataract where you can see a stellate cataract. This is a partial stellate cataract. In this photograph also, you can crop out the remaining part of the bright overexposed area. This is a microspherophakia where the lens has been anterior subluxated, and these photographs are also difficult to take properly. You need to change the illumination such that you are able to show the anterior, the lens being anterior displaced, so that you can identify that this is a lens and not an oil globule. You should be able to pick out all the features of the image. And specular reflection photographs can also be taken with smartphone. So this is how it was taken. You need to make a slit. You need to change it to the area of maximum reflection. That is, change it to 60 degrees on both sides, on the illuminating arm as well as the viewing arm. Focus on the area of maximum reflection and then adjust the brightness. Touch to focus, adjust the brightness in maximum magnification till you can see the structure. So in my smartphone, it was just barely visible. This was the original photograph. So in this photograph, you can just barely see this endothelial cells. A friend of mine took this photographs using a DSLR. So this is how you do it. You make a slit. This is your area of interest, where this is the reflection from the epithelium, which is not required. This is the reflection from the endothelium, which you want. So zoom into that area and further zoom into that area, and then you can see the endothelial cells. Further zoom in, you can see the endothelial cells better. So this was taken with a DSLR camera, but I think you can do that with the better smartphone cameras also. Mine is a mid-range smartphone. So I think a better smartphone would give better specular images. For gonioscopy, you need a regular gonioscopic mechanisms. You need a rotatable slit, tiltable illumination will be better. Polarizing filter also will be better. You can take gonioscopic photographs in the same way, and you can take pseudo-exfoliation the angle. I believe this is the same pseudo-exfoliation which was seen in the inferior angle in the slit lamp photograph taken using a gonioscope, which shows a chunk of pseudo-exfoliation at the inferior angle. And this is a blood clot. This looks like neovascularization here, but it is not. It is after a peripheral iodotomy, there was some bleeding which went into the inferior angle. And you can take fundus photographs using a smartphone, slit lamp, and 90D as we have seen earlier, 90D or 78D lens. You can also do it with a smartphone and a 20 diopter lens as we have seen. And you can help that 20 diopter lens stay fixed using many things. One is a plastic bottle which holds a lens from the phone. You can use this 3D printed one from Odox fundus from New Zealand. You can use dye retcam, that is do it yourself retcam, which I worked with Dr. Biju Raju for this on how to make your own device, just a PVC pipe, a plastic pipe to keep the 20 diopter lens at a particular distance from the smartphone. Then there is MII Made in India retcam by Dr. Ashish Sharma. Then there is Jai's retcam by Dr. Jaitra. All these are having the same principle of holding the 20 diopter lens at a particular distance from the smartphone and providing a closed environment to prevent reflections from the room illumination. You can, so the first method you can take using a slit lamp and a 20 diopter or 90 diopter, 78 diopter or 90 diopter lens. So I found that some LED slit lamps give flickering light in the image if it is kept in lower illumination. So when I increase the brightness, it went away. I believe it's a issue with the frequency of the AC current. So I think the newer ones with better power supplies will not have this issue. But if there is that issue, it can be solved by changing the brightness to maximum. These are some photographs of the fundus taken with the smartphone and 20 diopter lens. And I will just show you some videos also, which I have taken with a 90 diopter lens and a smartphone on a slit lamp. On the left, you can see a patient with pseudo exfoliation. I have used a 90 diopter lens and you can see the fundus clearly. This was edited on a smartphone itself using a smartphone. On the right side, you can see, if you look closely, here there is a PVD, a posterior vitreous detachment, which can be seen as a vase ring. If it can be seen only when it is focused. So now I focus on the retina, I focus now onto the vase ring. So that is very important, focus, exposure and focus. The other method is by using smartphone and a 20 diopter lens. This is the do-it-yourself retcam, which can be seen as a PVC pipe which fixes the 20 diopter lens at a particular distance from the smartphone. This is Dr. Biju Raju demonstrating the fundus photography technique. If you go to this link, or if you go to this journal article, which is the same link, you can see the further details of how to build your own smartphone fundus camera. It's very simple. You can make it out of $1 worth of materials and your smartphone and a 20 diopter lens. So these are some smartphone fundus photographs taken directly without any adapter, just a 20 diopter lens and a smartphone. This is another photograph of the same type. If you look at these two videos, If you look at these two videos, you can see the retinal detachment an exudative retinal tear. So this patient is on the left side, it's a patient in sitting position. On the right side, it's a patient in supine position. So if you look closely, you can see a small retinal detachment inferiorly. On the video on the right, you can see the bullous retinal detachment which has occupied the entire space here. So this shows shifting fluid in exudative retinal detachment. This patient was later found to have VKH, Wog-Koyanagi-Hirada disease. So other methods of fundus photography include the Remedio smartphone fundus adapter, which gives pretty good photographs. It gives us coaxial illumination here so that you can take non-mediatic photographs also. Then you have the DI, which is a very small device which provides coaxial illumination, and it is very similar to the peak retina, which is a very small device which provides coaxial illumination. These give small fundus photographs which cover a small area, and these are the kind of photographs you get with that. But with the latest iPhone 10, you don't even need a lens because the illumination is coaxial. So this is I believe Dr. Chandra or somebody. Okay, so this was published recently, like last month. He used a smartphone iPhone 10 which had almost coaxial illumination to take fundus photographs of himself without using any additional equipment. This is with an extra macro lens attached to the smartphone and a 20 diopter lens. This is with a direct ophthalmoscope through the viewing part of the direct ophthalmoscope. And the easiest is obviously to use the previous method, that is the 20 diopter lens on a PVC pipe or a plastic bottle. That is also very easy. This is a Van Heddick's grading. This is the hypermature cataract. This is pseudo exfoliation. This is the DMT. I'll show you two more videos. This is on the left, a phacoelytic glaucoma. On the right, this is the normal aqueous currents. Aqueous currents in a post-operative patient. So this is a post-op uveitis. You can see the movement of the aqueous demonstrated by the flow of the pigments in the anterior chamber. On the left, you can see the sparkling lens particles, which also follow the flow of aqueous in the anterior chamber, which is this direction. On the iris, it rises up, and at the cornea, it comes down. And if you look at the future methods, you can use smartphone to find the toric axis. Because it has the gyroscope, you can find the horizontal, you can find out how much tilt is there. You can have photo editing apps, Photoshop Express, PhotoGrid, and Multilayer are useful apps to edit your photographs after you have taken them. Videos can also be edited. You can use Filmora Go, InShot, or iMovie on iPhone. So Filmora Go is what I use regularly, and InShot is the other one which I use regularly. InShot is for short videos. The options are less, but it is much easier to work with. Filmora Go is like a regular video editing software where you have all the options. And this is a list of useful apps. If you want to have a look, these apps, the Camera FV5 should be useful. Rest of it do the same thing. On an iPhone, Filmic Pro will be useful. 3D Steroid is for 3D photographs, stereo photographs. Fundus photography, you can use the HopeScope app or the Ullman Indirect app, or the MII Made in India Red Cam app. For editing, these are the photographs, I have talked about them. For video editing, Filmora Go, InShot, and iMovie are the useful apps. I think that is all that I would like to talk about. So this is for surgery recording. If you need more space, you can add an external storage. So you can even add an external hard drive in some cases, but these require more power. So most of the smartphones, they have the option to add a OTG, on-the-go USB drive, even the iPhone. Even though it does not support external memory card, you can add an on-the-go USB device, which can be also connected to a computer using the other port on the other side of the device. Then there is the option of wireless videography. You can use an Apple TV if you have an iPhone, directly cast it onto an Apple TV. If you have a Chromecast, you can do that also. Or you can use other casting devices like EasyCast or AnyCast, which is available in India for very cheap. And you can cast from Android phones or iPhones to any of these. So while you're recording your slit lamp photographs, while you're recording your surgeries, you can record and cast it onto the screen, a large screen, using these dongles which connect to the HDMI port of your TVs. And you can also do live streaming. So you can do live streaming online using either Facebook Live, YouTube Live, Periscope, or Meerkat, or Ustream. All these support direct streaming and recording of your videos from the phone. So 3D stereo photography is a very useful part of ophthalmology, which is not given much importance here in India. I believe there you do take a lot of stereo photographs. So there is work being done on using smartphones to take stereo photographs also. So if you want to take it with smartphones, you need two identical smartphones because the cameras have to be identical, and you can fix each camera to each eyepiece of a stereo microscope and record. Once it is recorded, you can separately combine them and you can view them using either a stereo viewer if you have one, or a virtual reality headset like Google Cardboard virtual reality headset. Or if you have a 3D TV, you can use that. Or you can convert it to an anaglyph format and watch it using the red-blue glasses. So binocularity is very essential in ophthalmology, in slit lamp, 90D examination, indirect ophthalmology, and eye surgeries. So it's very important and it is not given much importance. So 3D photography, essentially, it is two photographs taken, one interpupillary distance apart. If you put more distance, the depth is exaggerated. If you put less distance, it is reduced. So there's an app for that. Everything has an app. So there is 3D steroid, or for iPhone it is i3D steroid. You can take two photographs side by side using the same principles as the slit lamp photography. Take one through the left eyepiece, one through the right eyepiece. The software can combine these two photographs into a combined image. This is a parallel view. This is what you would use with the stereo viewer. Left image is on the left and right image is on the right. You can change to any of these modes of viewing. That would include anaglyph. The red blue anaglyph is there on the left on this. I have not shown that option. It also includes a mirror method. You keep a mirror in the center and view the photograph. You can have the wiggle method, you can use the parallax method. So among these, the parallel method will be the one which is used for stereo viewers or 3D TVs if you have that. And you can do 3D videography also using two iPhones and instead of two smartphones, doesn't have to be iPhones. And you can combine the videos in real time using an app, Camerada. So this is the same thing as you would do if you recorded from two phones separately and combined them using a software. The software does it for you. Or you can use a specialized 3D camera if you have the 3D camera. But if you have two identical smartphones, this is good enough. You can also use a lens splitter. I have found that these lens splitters are not of very good quality because they use back silvered mirrors. If you get one with a front silvered mirror or prisms, you would get better 3D photographs. Otherwise, there is a lot of reflection and the images are not apposed correctly. You can watch these 3D images or videos with a 3D TV with the red blue anaglyph glasses. This is a slit lamp 3D photograph which I have taken. You can also use a Google Cardboard headset. This is also another slit lamp 3D photograph you have taken. And this is from the Ophthalmic Photographer Society. This was a side-by-side image which I combined using a Stereo Maker app. It's a free app available online to make it into an anaglyph image. You put these red-blue glasses, you can see this image properly. There is an optic disc pit here in addition to the large disc. So you have to put the 3D glasses to actually make out the depth within the depth. This is glaucomatous cupping, and these are very useful for glaucoma specialists. Google Cardboard can also be used to see the depth of images. You can put your smartphone with the parallel view side by side images in your Google Cardboard headset, which is quite affordable. I think it should come within a few dollars, and you can see the 3D. So this is a bleb, overhanging bleb, and this is a penetrating keratoplasty. You can get 3D content online. That is, iTube 3D recently started a section for 3D surgery, 3D videos. You have 3D endoscopic procedures. You have YouTube 3D also. So YouTube 3D was there for a long time, several years. Some of these videos go back to 7 and 8 years back. If you search for eye surgeries and search for 3D eye surgeries, you can get these. Thank you, everyone. I would like to thank everyone for the opportunity to speak in this. And if you have any questions, I think I have received some questions, I will gladly answer them. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Akkara. I do have a few questions. The first one is, do you know the name of the brand of the first device described?
The slit lamp adapter, there are several brands. Most of them come from China. The one which I use is from OutGeek. Then there is another one called Smile Drive. All of them are identical. I think they are all manufactured probably in the same factory in China and given different brand names.
Okay, thank you. I do have another question as well. Uh-huh. With the smartphone slit lamp adapter, do you recommend only using the right eyepiece to attach the adapter to and photograph through?
No. So if you hold the adapter, if you hold the phone in your hand and take photographs, I tend to use the left eyepiece. If you want to use the right eyepiece, it is not... is not easier or more difficult. When I want to take Goldman Appletition tonometry, I find that it is always aligned to the left eyepiece. So depending on where you are comfortable with, you can use either eyepiece.
Okay, thank you. And I do have one last question here. Mm-hmm. How long did it take to develop the DY Retcam, and what device for fundus imaging do you receive the best quality with?
Okay, so DIY Retcam, there were several groups doing fundus photography by holding a 20 diopter lens in the left hand and the smartphone in the right hand, and it had been there for I think maybe 10 years or so, five years, I suppose. And we observed that, and then we have also seen some people were trying to put together a device to hold it together. So working on the previous work, we developed it within a few months. We just realized that we should make it, found the easiest way to make it and put the instructions out there. A few months.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to wait just a few minutes here to see if there's any additional questions. Mm-hmm. Would you mind if people would want to contact you just showing the first slide that you had with your email address?
I don't mind. Please do email me. I might take a few days to respond, but I will definitely respond to all the emails. You can email me on my email, that is johndavisakkara@gmail.com. I can put that slide. You can email me at this address.
Perfect. Thank you.
Anything else you would like to know about slit lamp photography or gonioscopy, photo editing? I can actually speak about, the slides, I think it will be available as a video soon.
Yes, that's correct. We will have it posted and we will try and get it up as quickly as possible.
Okay. So that will be uploaded on the Ophthalmic Photographer Society website soon.
Yes, we can send it to them directly.
Okay. Okay, I also mentioned that you can measure lesions using smartphones. So if you are interested, and we do have a couple of minutes left, I can show you that. Is anybody interested in knowing how to measure lesions on the smartphone photographs?
Yes, I would be very interested in that.
Okay, so I'll just skip over to that now. So I have, it's here. So I just presented it recently. Okay, so I'll just go over it right now. I'll just go to the main points, which are, okay. So usually how you measure slit lamp images is using ImageJ or Fiji. Are you familiar with these apps, these softwares?
I'm not, no.
Okay, so if you are doing it on the computer, these are the softwares which you would want to use. And if you want to measure something, you can use these, draw a reference marking. So if you know the white to white diameter of the cornea, you can reference that and then do all sorts of measurements, including areas, lengths, angles, even brightness differences using these softwares. So these are the softwares which are the best on the computer and you can use them. But on the smartphone, you can do the same thing using this particular app, which is called Image Meter app. You can use the same thing, take an image, draw the reference scale. I think I will mute the audio here. You draw the reference scale. So this patient's white to white was say 11.7 millimeters. So you put that, and then you can put this away, push it off from your area of interest. And this patient has a corneal ulcer with a hypopyon. Take a measuring tool. So here I am taking dimension and I am measuring the length, the height of the hypopyon. So I get 1.67 millimeters. This is calculated based on the reference marking. So you have the another thing you can measure is the width of the hypopyon. Just click and drag. This is all done on a smartphone. So once you do that, you have the height and the width of the hypopyon. You can also measure area. So you go to area and then you can draw here. When you're drawing, you can always see this zoomed in version of your image. And here you get the area. You get all the lengths which you have marked and the area. So that is how you measure things using your smartphone. The app is called Image Meter. You can measure ptosis, you can measure IPD, you can measure the disc parameters, including the ratios. You can measure anything which has a reference marking. So this is what I was trying to say. It can be done on the smartphone. If you do it on the computer, these are the apps, these are the softwares which are regularly used. The app, I'll just show you the name of the app again. It's called Image Meter. It's made for architects. So that's all. I just wanted to mention this particular method which can be used in addition to the smartphone imaging. You can measure also. Thank you.
Oh, well, that was wonderful. Very fascinating. I have two other questions before, if you don't mind. One is, has this been helpful in documenting change in pathology improvement with your treatment?
Yes. So when you can measure the corneal ulcers, you can actually decide whether the corneal ulcer is improving with your treatment, whether the area of infiltration is reducing or it is increasing. If you just note it down on paper, it's not very reliable. But once you have images and you have measurements, it is very useful to know what is happening with your treatment. And yes, you can use both Android and iPhone interchangeably. This app is available for both.
Thank you. One last question. How do you find the time to take the videos you record, or do you have another staff member insert them into the patient's record?
So I do not have another staff member to help me out. So if the patient crowd is less and I can find the time, I do take these photos and videos. I do it in my free time. And it takes a bit of time to start with, but once you start doing it, it becomes faster and easier for you.
Thank you. It's just amazing that this is available. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone.
One last reminder. I just wanted to make sure that everyone does take their quiz. It is included in the email that was sent with the webinar link. And I wanted to also let you know that we do have webinars in March starting up. I don't see any other questions, so I just wanted to thank you very much, Dr. Akkara, for your time and just the fascinating presentation that you did today. It was wonderful.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, and you have a good evening.
It's a morning time for me.
Well, good morning. Have a great day.
Thank you.
All right. Good night. Okay. Or good day.
Good day, thank you. Good night to you. Uh-huh.